Welcome back to the neurology section of 12 Days in March. Today, we'll launch part two of our stroke series. Here's a reminder of the big picture for our stroke series, and we'll be focusing on lacunar strokes in this installment. In part one, we talked about localizing strokes to the major cerebral arteries when either the face or leg plus arm are involved. But today, we'll be talking about strokes that involve all of the above. To understand lacunar strokes, we need to give the little arteries some love. Size isn't everything on the NBME. There are small arteries, including the lenticulostriate arteries pictured here, that branch off from the major cerebral vessels to supply some of the deep structures of the brain. The basal ganglia, internal capsule, and thalamus are all supplied by small branches off either the ACA, MCA, or PCA. Occlusions in these small arteries can have massive and devastating consequences. Moving into our first presentation of lacunar stroke, this patient will present with paralysis of the right side of their entire body, face, arm, and leg. No other signs or symptoms. The big tip off here is that it paralyzes both the face plus arm and the leg. Think back to the homunculus with its great wall between the arm and leg, and you'll recall that an ACA or MCA occlusion can't do that on step one. Furthermore, an internal capsule lesion would present with purely motor symptoms, but an ACA or MCA stroke could easily have lots of other signs and symptoms, which we went over in detail in part one of our series. So this is a left-sided lacunar stroke caused by occluding one of the small lenticulostriate arteries that branch off of the MCA, supplying blood to the internal capsule. Let's take a field trip back to neuroanatomy and recall that the internal capsule is the tight bundle of motor axons that have traveled down from the homunculus in the primary motor cortex of the frontal lobe and through the brain's white matter. The fibers in the internal capsule will eventually turn into the corticospinal and corticobulbar tracts when they reach the brainstem and spinal cord. Because these fibers carry only motor inputs, that's why you get a pure motor hemiparesis. To help you visualize this a little better, think of the primary motor cortex as the flowers on this beautiful bouquet and the stems as the axons traveling down into the spinal cord, where they start to condense around the rubber band. That's just like the internal capsule. Got it? Complete contralateral hemiparesis with no other signs and symptoms is a lacunar infarction, not an ACA or MCA occlusion. Small vessel, major motor consequence. Here come the derivatives. Who's at greatest risk of any type of lacunar stroke? Patients with long-standing hypertension. That's one of many reasons why our patient and provider here seems so happy to be on top of this patient's blood pressure. Think of the high pressure in the vessels as creating a hardened and thickened vessel lumen over years that eventually blocks off blood flow to the distal parts of the vessel, and that's how you can get an ischemic lacunar stroke of the internal capsule. So putting this all together, here's how the NBME may come after you. They might present a scenario where a patient experiences acute onset of facial, arm, and leg paralysis with slurred speech dysarthria. Then they may ask you to localize the stroke to a small lenticulostriate artery that supplies the internal capsule. Or they may give you the diagnosis as a lacunar stroke involving the internal capsule and ask what the patient's greatest contributing risk factor was for this acute presentation. This is how they play the game for internal capsule lacunar strokes. Let's look at another presentation of lacunar infarction. In this presentation, a patient reports a sudden inability to feel the entire left side of their body, including face, arm, and leg. No other deficits. And here comes the big ticket item. 3 weeks later, they get a terrible pain whenever anything touches the left side of their body. What happened here? This is classic for a thalamic stroke from occlusion of a small branch off the right PCA. Notice that the deficit is sensory only and that it is complete one-sided contralateral sensory loss. An ACA or MCA stroke could not do this for two reasons. They won't present with complete hemisensory loss, and you'd expect motor deficits as well. The NBME likes to ask about this strange one-sided pain phenomenon that develops a few weeks after their complete unilateral sensory loss. After this video, you'll have no problems recognizing this as allodynia after a lacunar stroke affecting the contralateral somatosensory thalamus. it's worth taking another field trip back to neuroanatomy to understand how this happens. Look at how much these kids love the thalamus. Your reaction should be just like theirs if you get a question about complete hemisensory loss and allodynia several weeks later. First, remember the function of the thalamus is to relay sensory inputs from outside the brain into the brain. Those inputs include somatic sensation, vision, and hearing, to name a few. Here's a PSA that the internal capsule and thalamus do not cross paths, and that means that the thalamus does not control motor inputs to the body. Now, believe me, I recognize this is a complicated diagram, but please don't worry about memorizing this entire diagram unless you want to go into neurology. And even you future neurologists have plenty of time to get this whole thing down. All you need to appreciate is how the thalamus is very geographically divided by function. Imagine a small lacunar stroke that damages only the yellow portions, those are the VPL and VPM nuclei of the thalamus, and you can easily picture how a patient with this type of stroke wouldn't have any other deficits like visual or motor. We've been dealing with absolutes so far and talking about pure motor and pure somatosensory deficits, but what if a patient gets complete unilateral hemisensory loss and complete hemiparesis? The only thing that can do that on step one without additional deficits like cortical or brainstem signs would be a stroke that hits both the sensory thalamus and the internal capsule. Think about rupture of a small vessel microaneurysm, aka a Charcot-Bouchard microaneurysm, in the thalamus that extends into the internal capsule. This one is a bit confusing, but when you think about how the patient lacks cortical signs like aphasia or visual deficits, you know it can't be a cortical infarction. There's no cranial nerve deficits, which means it cannot be brainstem. So this is a tricky one, but be on the lookout for a small vessel hemorrhagic stroke that hits the sensory thalamus and internal capsule that affects the entire side of a patient's face and body. Why do these small aneurysms develop? Just like lacunar strokes, it's long-standing high blood pressure that weakens the walls of these small vessels that causes these balloon-like dilations, which are ticking time bombs for rupture under high arterial pressure. Be like our favorite provider here and treat your patient's hypertension aggressively. They might thank you later. And finally, if a patient presents with sudden onset hemibolism, that is one-sided flinging movements, the stroke is in their contralateral subthalamic nucleus, which is a part of the basal ganglia circuitry that influences control over movements. Not sure why, but the boards love this little tidbit. They'll describe sudden onset of one-sided flinging movements like the patient shown here and ask you to localize the lesion. Simple, it's the contralateral subthalamic nucleus. Let's summarize what we just covered. If you're dealing with an acute stroke that involves both the face slash arm and the leg, you know you cannot be dealing with an MCA or ACA stroke on the boards. Again, MCA strokes can do that in real life, but don't worry about that for now. Once you've recognized that you have face, arm, and leg involvement, look for whether motor, sensory, or both are impacted. Unilateral pure motor involvement should raise red flags for a lenticulostriate arterial occlusion causing a lacunar stroke that hits the contralateral internal capsule only. On the flip side, unilateral pure somatosensory deficits should make you think of a PCA deep branch occlusion that hits only the contralateral somatosensory thalamus. Remember too that these strokes can present weeks later with allodynia or post-thalamic pain syndrome on that same side. If both sensory and motor are involved, think about a rupture of a small microaneurysm that is extended from the thalamus into the internal capsule. And finally, remember that a contralateral subthalamic nucleus stroke will cause one-sided hemibolism. And that does it for part two of the 12-day stroke series. In part three, we'll discuss brainstem and spinal cord strokes. Stay tuned. As always, feel free to email with any questions. See you next time.